Well, you don't need to be tired, I was too.
Yeah. Right.
Those are not like them.
Long time.
I'm using big.
You speak?
I can.
Yeah, long time.
You could block two pins over there and I doubt it.
Wonder how T. Marie would go in those, huh?
Thank you, thank you.
What about the other?
Or Kahlua.
Yeah.
Here's the proof I found.
Oh, what's in them?
No, no, I was just suggesting that.
Don't you think that's the perfect spot for this video? Don't you think that's the perfect spot because it's completely out of the line?
Licorice?
Yeah, it's a little licorice.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah, you can pick it up.
I shouldn't have said that was the perfect spot.
Jeez.
Those are the same numbers you put up last time.
Is some statement that would describe the content of each one of these sections. That's what we're doing. All right. Would you agree with the first part? That's the argument dealing with the nature of death. As the separation and the release of the soul. Two key concepts. Separation and release of the soul. Remember, there's a whole process involved in that. Now, we just finished from 70 to 84. How would you characterize that? Good punch players.
Problem of life and death.
How about Socrates' pitch?
For what purpose?
The likely story to overcome the fears of Socrates.
What?
Likely arguments or likely accounts to overcome what?
The fears. Of Phoebe.
Nope.
The fears of the many.
The dissolution of the soul.
Phoebe's expresses of the many.
Right. Of the many, right.
Of the many. Overcome the fears of the many.
And in that sense, they were hiding behind the fears of the many. We could say, because they took upon themselves to represent the position of the many. Therefore, when that has been done, completed, what are they left with? They then have to come out and state really where they're at.
Where they're at, huh?
And that begins from 84 on. There's a division here. There's another break, by the way, but I didn't put it down here, but I'm sure you'll discover it. And let's see whether we can get to it. Right? I'm sure we'll be able to. And there's another interior break that becomes important for us. There's another way of demonstrating the breaks. And that's at 88D. Right? That's the second kind of division. There are two kinds of division in this way. Maybe we just make that one unit and we'll see it. All right. Fair enough. We got some readers in charge ahead. Lobie? How about Lobie? Either one's up to you guys. Good. Any readers?
I'll read.
We need several. We need CBs and SIMs.
Well, I'll read.
All right. Which?
Give me Sock.
Sock, all right. You'll play? SIMs?
SIMs.
All right. We need the CBs. In the lobe.
I'll narrate.
When Socrates had said this, there was a profound and deep and penetrating silence, which he was absorbed for a long time. Socrates himself was apparently so absorbed in this profound state. As he reflected on it, he said, as were most of us, which suggested to us all that some of us weren't listening.
Where are you?
84C.
293, 84C,
it's reading between the lines.
My translations just happens to be a little different.
It's from Brooklyn.
I thought mine was.
Oh, good.
His translation marches to a different drum.
Do you think there is any incompleteness in what has been said? There are still many subjects for doubt and many points open to attack, if anyone cares to discuss the matter thoroughly. If you are considering anything else, I have nothing to say. But if you are in any difficulty about these matters, do not hesitate to speak and discuss them yourselves. If you think anything better could be said on the subject, then take me along with you in the discussion, if you think you can get on better in my company.
Socrates, I'll tell you the truth. For some time, each of us has been in doubt and has been egging the other on and urging him to ask a question. Because we wish to hear your answer, but hesitate to trouble you for fear that it may be disagreeable to you in your present misfortune.
Ah, Simeon, I should have hard work to persuade other people that I do not regard my present situation as a misfortune, when I cannot even make you believe it. But you are afraid I am more churlish. What is that word?
Churlish.
Churlish? What does it mean?
Like a churl, like
fretful?
No, like a irritable.
Irritable?
Well, in a little way. Yes.
This guy has a very interesting.
Oh, fretful? Ralph says fretful.
Churlish?
Truly.
Churlish is supposed to be more like a bad guy. Because a churl is like a bad guy.
Yeah.
Well, it's the case, if I can't convince you, it's going to be hard to do other people. Right. But you are afraid I'm more churlish now than I used to be. And you seem to think I am inferior in prophetic power to the swans who sing at other times also. When they feel they are to die, sing most and best in their joy, that they are to go to the God whose servants they are. But men, because of their own fear of death, misrepresent the swans and say that they sing for sorrow in mourning for their own death. But they do not consider that no bird sings when it is hungry or cold or has any other trouble. No, not even the nightingale or the swallow or the whooping, who are said to sing in lamentation. I do not believe they sing for grief, nor do the swans. But since they are Apollo's birds, I believe they have prophetic vision. And because they have foreknowledge of the blessings in the other world, they sing and rejoice on that day more than ever before. And I think that I am myself a fellow servant of the swans, and am consecrated to the same God, and have received from our master the gift of prophecy no inferior to theirs, and that I go out from life with as little sorrow as they. So far as this is concerned, then, speak and ask whatever questions you please, so long as the 11 of the Athenians permit.
Good. I will tell you my difficulty, and then Cebes in turn will say why he does not agree to all you have said. I think, Socrates, as perhaps you do yourself, that it is either impossible or very difficult to acquire clear knowledge about these matters in this life. Let me try that again. I think, Socrates, as perhaps you do yourself, that it is either impossible or very difficult to acquire clear knowledge about these matters in this life. And yet, he is a weakling who does not test in every way what is said about them, and persevere until he is worn out by studying them on every side. Excuse me. He's wearing out his soul here. For he must do one of two things. Either he must learn or discover the truth about these matters. For he must do one of two things. Either he must learn or discover the truth about these matters. Or if that is impossible, he must take whatever human doctrine is best and hardest to disprove, and embarking upon it as upon a raft, sail upon it through life in the midst of dangers, unless he can sail upon some stronger vessel, some divine revelation, and make his voyage more safely and securely. And so now I am not ashamed to ask questions, since you encourage me to do so, and I shall not have to blame myself hereafter for not saying now what I think. For Socrates, when I examine what has been said, either alone or with Cebes, it does not seem quite satisfactory.
Perhaps, my friend, you are right. But tell me in what respect it is not satisfactory.
In this, that one might use the same argument about harmony and a lyre with its strings. One might say that the harmony is invisible and incorporeal and very beautiful and divine in the well-attuned lyre. But the lyre itself and its strings are bodies, incorporeal and composite and earthy and akin to that which is mortal. Now, if someone shatters the lyre or cuts and breaks the strings, what if he should maintain, by the same argument you employ, that the harmony could not have perished and must still exist? For there would be no possibility that the lyre and its strings, which are of mortal nature, still exist after the strings are broken. And the harmony, which is related and akin to the divine and the immortal. For there would be no possibility that the lyre and its strings, which are of mortal nature, still exist after the strings are broken. And the harmony, which is related and akin to the divine and the immortal, perish before that which is mortal. He would say that the harmony must still exist somewhere, and that the wood and the strings must rot away before anything could happen to it. And I fancy, Socrates, that it must have occurred to your own mind that we believe the soul to be something after this fashion, that our body is strung and held together by heat, cold, moisture, dryness, and the like, and the soul is a mixture and a harmony of these same elements when they are well and properly mixed. Now, if the soul is a harmony, it is clear that when the body is too much relaxed or is too tightly strung by diseases or other ills, The soul must of necessity perish, no matter how divine it is, like other harmonies in sounds and in all the works of artists. And the remains of each body will endure a long time until they are burnt or decayed. Now, what shall we say to this argument? If anyone claims that the soul, being a mixture of the elements of the body, is the first to perish in what is called death.
Simmius raises a fair objection. Now, if any of you is readier than I, why does he not reply to him? For he seems to score a good point. However, I think before replying to him, we ought to hear what fault our friend Cebes finds with our argument, that we may take time to consider what to say. And then, when we have heard them, we can either agree with them, if they seem to strike the proper note, or if they do not, we can proceed to argument in defense of our reason. Come, Cebes, tell us what it was that troubled you.
Well, I will tell you. The argument seems to me to be just where it was, and to be still open to the objection I made before. For I do not deny that it has been very cleverly, and, if I may say so, conclusively shown that the soul existed before it entered into this bodily form. But it does not seem to me proved that it will still exist when it's either dead. I do not agree with Simeon's objection that the soul is not stronger and more lasting than the body, but I think it is far superior in all such respects. Why then, the argument might say, do you still disbelieve when you see that after a man dies, the weaker part still exists? Do you not think the stronger part must necessarily be preserved during the same length of time? Now see if my reply to this has any sense. I think I may, like Simeon, best express myself in a figure. It seems to me that it is much as if one should say about an old weaver who had died, that the man had not perished but was safe and sound somewhere, and should offer as a proof of this the fact that the cloak which the man had woven and used to wear was still whole and had not perished. And if anyone did not believe him, he would ask which lasts longer, a man or a cloak that is in use and wear. And when the answer was given that a man lasts much longer, he would think it had been proved beyond a doubt that the man is safe, because that which was left lasting had not perished. But I do not think he is right. That's for me. But I do not think he is right, Simeon. And I ask you especially to notice what I say. Anyone can understand that a man who says this is talking, that a man who says this is talking nonsense. For the weaver in question wove and wore out many such cloaks and lasted longer than they, though they were many, but perished. For the weaver in question wove and wore out many such cloaks and lasted longer than they, though they were many, but perished, I suppose, before the last one. Yet a man is not feebler or weaker than a cloak on that account at all. And I think the same figure would apply to the soul and the body, and it would be quite appropriate to say in like manner about them, that the soul lasts a longer time, but the body lasts a shorter time and is weaker. And one might go on to say that each soul wears out many bodies, especially if the man lives many years. For the body is constantly changing and being destroyed while the man still lives, and the soul is always weaving anew that which wears out. Then, when the soul perishes, it must necessarily have on its last garments, and this only will survive it. And when the soul has perished, then the body will at once show its natural weakness and will quickly disappear and decay. And so we are not yet justified in feeling sure on the strength of this argument that our souls will still exist somewhere after we are dead. For if one were to grant even more to a man who uses your argument, Socrates, and allow not only that our soul existed before we were born, but also that there is nothing to prevent some of them from continuing to exist and from being born and dying again many times after we are dead, because the soul is naturally so strong that it can endure repeated births, even allowing this, one might not grant that it does not suffer by its many births and does not finally perish altogether in one of its deaths. But he might say that no one knows beforehand the particular death and the particular dissolution of the body, which brings destruction to the soul, for none of us can perceive that. Now, if this is the case, anyone who feels confident about death is a foolish confidence, unless he can show that the soul is altogether immortal and imperishable. Otherwise, a man who is about to die must always fear that his soul will perish utterly in the impending dissolution of the body. Now, all of us, as we remark to one another afterwards...
This isn't you, this is Fido, I believe. This is Amiri. Yeah.
What a confession.
Well, who's going to play?
Well, that's great.
Okay.
Now, all of us, as we remark to one another afterwards, were quite disturbed because we couldn't put a greatest efforts of ours understand why Simmias and Cebes didn't ask Socrates to continue his discussion about his prophetic arts so he could inform us about his vision. Because clearly he said God had a gift and he was a master of prophecy and therefore had a right to suspect that where he was going was eminently worth listening. But no, they went within themselves and came up with something entirely different. So we were puzzled by it for a long time. Yeah?
Right.
In dismay, hopefully, the whole discussion would not follow along the questions of Simmias and Cebes and neglect the vision of Socrates.
Yeah.
But alas.
And so we were hoping, considering the arguments that Cebes and Simmias gave, that at least they would then go back so that that section could be completed. Right, that way, what your translation reads?
You must have an annotated edition on.
Oh.
Perhaps mine just has a large gap in the ancient manuscripts.
It's a different manuscript.
Different manuscript, that's
it.
My scribe must have fallen asleep.
Yes.
Okay, let's get them both up. Right? Make the analogy. Basic analogy of Simmias.
So the harp and the lyre.
And
the
body. Right? The fire is the body. As
harmony
is to. So, and Cebes?
Cloth is to body.
What?
I was just saying, as the man or the wearer is to the
weaver.
Weaver, I'm sorry. Weaver.
So then, all right, these are the basic analogies. What we need to do is express all the relationships that exist in those terms so that you can see the whole thing. A couple of points that will later, I imagine, have some fun with this. But one, a couple of points I'd like. One, curiosity. Am I fair for curiosity?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Open your book at random, okay? Open your globe at random anywhere. Okay? Everyone have different faith. Anywhere. Got it? Okay. Now make a statement about the number of words in the English versus the Greek, just by a little inspection. Okay. Do it again. All right. And then do it for page 299.
Strange. Strange. Oh, I didn't hear you talking about.
And what do you notice?
A lot more Greek.
Isn't that amazing? I mean, all of a sudden the English language has the great powers of condensation. Just done saying, right?
It's even amazing the way it does. If you look at the Greek on the page, it like it just kind of compacts down towards C. That's the kind of, because it's wider space up at the top.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Lines per inch too. Different.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right
down there.
Right.
Let me see another page.
So we need a third one there, don't we? By the way. Can someone do the other one? You could say Socrates is to death as swans are to their imminent death. Right? And as swans are to their imminent death and have a swan song. Right? Right. Actually, we should spell it out, right? Because it's actually more terms than that. Socrates is the death, is God as swans, call it swan song. Right? Swan song is to their death as swan is to Apollo as Socrates is to Apollo. Passage where Socrates says he's the master. Right? He's a master. God, don't tell me it says something in bold. Clear up. Say he's the master. He has received from our master a gift of prophecy. He's a master. He just hasn't received the gift of it. He's a master of it. So that, in that respect, Socrates is to his death as a swan song is to their death as a swan is to Apollo, as Socrates is to Apollo. All right? See, it has to be expanded further on a higher level. And the higher level then will be, see, we're moving higher. And therefore, the next set of terms has to be as a swan is prophetic, as a swan is only prophetic at his death, at their death, as Socrates is the master of prophecy from Apollo. So this is a single occasion, isn't it? And there Socrates saying, I got the gift of prophecy, and beyond the gift, I've become a master. I'm the master of the gift of prophecy. So what word do you think we're going to have to make sure is there? Master.
Despotic.
Pardon?
Despotic. Be safe.
They have prophetic vision because they, in that section, are master or not?
Are you asking in English or Greek?
Greek.
Yeah, okay. That's Ken Sergei Boundary.
B6?
B6.
B6, Birds of Apollo.
Oh, E6.
No.
B6.
85.
Well, we're talking about swans, aren't we?
Well, the swans are first mentioned 84, 85.
Yeah, they're first mentioned.
No, I thought so.
But they...
85, 86. I haven't played the game before, so...
King on King, Monty King, the King product is this
book. He's saying page 294, four lines up from the bottom, second word in from the left.
So, well, okay, we're going to need someone there for it to finish this stuff. Finish the analogy.
Can I just say, you're saying that that's where he says he's the master?
Well, that's where the word master is used. I don't know if that's where he uses master.
Well, I'm just not sure what I'm looking at. That's what he says. Socrates is the master.
I would like to know what word he's using for the master.
That's from our master, isn't it?
That's where he receives the master king from the master.
The master, right. That's where I was at.
Yeah, as I said.
Where are you?
It's 84B.
Oh, excuse me, I misread that.
It's page 294, three lines up.
The same God had received from our master a gift of prophecy. Too bad. It was a great idea.
Listen.
It was a great
I wouldn't mind having Apollo as my master.
Oh, okay. All right. Would you agree then? We should go back and finish that and clear it up, all right? As a swan is only prophetic at their death and go to the god they serve, so Socrates, right? Gains a gift of prophecy. That's the gift of it, not an occasion. And so too, right? If the analogy holds.
Then it's no whit inferior to theirs.
Right? Yeah, but you see that according to the story that he's telling, the swan then goes to the god they serve, which is Apollo. So in the same way,
I thought to go to good masters.
Good masters are at least Apollo.
Right, that's it.
Okay. Now, no one, you know, what's interesting at that point, either Caesar's just going to say, well, okay, do it. Tell us about it. This is your swan song. You've been given the gift of prophecy. Tell us about the next world. Huh? I did. Did you want to hold me up? Go ahead. No, right ahead. I can run the state. As the swans. I don't mind. As the swans are only prophetic at the time of their death. And on death go to the god they serve. So Socrates has gained the gift of prophecy. Not confined only to the moment of his death. And equally then, must go to, on his death, go to the god that he has served. Okay, this has an impact then upon Phaedo and Eucrates both come in at this point. And that's the division in the text.
Vash. Come here. Vash. Come here.
Shall we pick up the dialogue from Phaedo and Eucrates?
We need a...
Ken?
Theo.
Oh. Nancy, here's somebody. Go ahead, you're up. Phaedo?
Phaedo?
Okay. Carol, you want to play Eucrates?
By the gods, Phaedo, I sympathize with you, for I myself, after listening to you, am inclined to ask myself, what argument shall we believe henceforth? For the argument of Socrates was perfectly convincing, and now it has fallen into discredit. For the doctrine that the soul is a kind of harmony has always had and has now a wonderful hold upon me, and your mention of it reminded me that I had myself believed it. Believed in it before. Now I must begin over again and find another argument to convince me that when a man dies, his soul does not perish with him. So for heaven's sake, tell how Socrates continued the discourse and whether he also, as you say the rest of you did, showed any uneasiness or calmly defended his argument. And did he defend it successfully? Tell us everything as accurately as you can.
Well, I must say, Socrates, I always wondered at Socrates, but I never wondered at him more than when I was with him then. To have something to say was perhaps no novelty in that man, but what most surprised me was how pleasant and friendly and respectful he was in welcoming the speculations of the young man, and then how sharply he saw how we were affected by what was said, and then how well he treated us and rallied us like a lot of beaten runaways, and headed us back to follow the argument and examine along with it.
Now, how did he do it?
I will tell you. I happened to be sitting on his right hand on a low stool beside his bed, and the seat was much higher than mine. Then he stroked my head and pinched together the hair on my neck. He used occasionally to play with my hair and said, tomorrow, perhaps, Phaedon, you'll cut off this pretty hair. It seems like it's Socrates. Wait a minute here.
Now, take my advice. Yeah, that's right. Now, you take my advice. Yeah.
That's right. Then do it again.
But why? You cut it off today, and I will cut mine if our argument dies and we cannot bring it to life again. If I were you and the argument escaped me, I would take an oath, like the Argives, not to let my hair grow until I had renewed the fight and won a victory over the argument of Simeus and Thebes.
But Socrates, 2-1. Not even Heracles could be a match for two, as they say.
Well, call me to help you, as your Iolaus, for there's still life.
I call you to help me, not as Heracles did to Iolaus, but Lycan, how do you pronounce that? Iolaus.
I go to Iolaus. That is all one. But first let us guard against the danger.
What's the danger?
The danger of becoming misologists.
Misanthropes?
Haters of logos. Haters of argument. As people become misanthropists, or haters of man. For no worse evil can happen to a man than to hate argument. Misology, misanthropy arise from similar causes. For misanthropy arises from trusting someone implicitly without sufficient knowledge. You think the man is perfectly true and sound and trustworthy. And afterwards you find him base and false. Then you have the same experience with another man. And by the time this happens to a man a good many times, especially if it happens among those whom he might regard as his nearest and dearest friends, he ends up by being in continual quarrels, and by hating everybody and thinking there is nothing sound in anyone at all. You not notice this?
Oh, yeah.
Well, is it not disgraceful? Is it not plain that such a man undertakes to consort with men when he has no knowledge of human nature? For if he had knowledge when he dealt with them, he would think that the good and the bad are both very few, and that those between the two are very many. That is the case.
What do you mean?
I mean just what I might say about the large and the small. Do you think there is anything more unusual than to find a very large or a very small man? Or dog, or any other creature, or again, one that is very quick or very slow. Very slow. Very ugly or extremely beautiful. Very black or very white. Or have you not noticed that the extremes in all these instances are rare and few, and the examples between the extremes are very many?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Don't you think that if there were to be a competition in rascality, those who excel would be very few in that also.
Quite likely.
This is really a great argument. Yes. Okay. Yes, very likely. But it's not in that respect that arguments are like men. I was merely following your lead in discussing that. The similarity lies in this. When a man without proper knowledge concerning arguments has confidence in the truth of an argument and afterward thinks that it is false, whether it really is so or not, and this happens again and again, then you know those men, especially who have spent their time in disputation, come to believe that they are the wisest of men and that they alone have discovered that there is nothing sound or sure in anything. whether argument or anything else, but all things go up and down like the tide in the Euripus, and nothing is stable for any length of time.
That is truly stated indeed.
Then, Phaedo, if there is any system of argument which is true and sure and can be learned, it would be a sad thing if a man, because he has met with some of those arguments which seem to be sometimes true and sometimes false, should then not blame himself for his lack of skill, but should end in his vexation by throwing the blame gladly upon the arguments, and should hate and revile them all the rest of his life, and be deprived of the truth and the knowledge of reality.
Yes, I do declare it would be pitiable.
First, then, let us be on our guard against this. Let us not admit into our souls the notion that there is no soundness in arguments at all. Let us far rather assume that we ourselves are not yet in sound condition, and that we must strive manfully and eagerly to become so, you and the others, for the sake of all your future lives, and I because of my impending death. For I fear that I am not just now in a philosophical frame of mind as regards this particular question, but am contentious, like quite uncultured persons. When they argue about anything, they do not care what the truth is in the matters they are discussing, but are eager only to make their own views seem true to their hearers. And I fancy I differ from them just now only to this extent. I shall not be eager to make what I say seem true to my hearers, except as a secondary matter, but I should be very eager to make myself believe it. Mm-hmm. For you see, my friend, how selfish my attitude is. If what I say is true, I am the gainer by believing it. And if there be nothing for me after death, at any rate I shall not be burdensome to my friends by my lamentations in these last moments. And this ignorance of mine will not last, for that would be an evil, but will soon end. So, Simmias and Cebes, I approach the argument with my mind thus prepared, but you, if you do as I ask, will give little thought to Socrates, and much more to the truth. And if you think what I say is true, agree to it, and if not, oppose me with every argument you can muster, that I may not in my eagerness deceive myself and you alike and go away like a bee having my sting sticking in you, leaving my sting sticking in you. Well, we must get to work. First, refresh my memory, if I seem to have forgotten anything. Shall I go? Can you keep going, Pierre?
No.
Okay. Simmias, I think, has doubts and fears that the soul, though more divine and excellent than the body, may perish first, being of the nature of a harmon. And Cebes, I believe, granted that the soul is more lasting than the body, but said that no one could know that the soul, after wearing out many bodies, did not at last perish itself upon leaving the body, and this was death, the destruction of the soul, since the body is continually being destroyed. Are those the points, Simmias and Cebes, which we must consider?
Oh, yeah.
I
was agreeing.
Who are you?
I'm Simmias.
She was both of us.
Cebes, where's Cebes?
Cebes over, sitting over there over the book. She's still thinking about agreeing.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Cebes has that different text.
Yeah.
You did an excellent job. Socrates, you're recounting how difficult.
Okay. Now, let's see. Now, do you reject all our previous arguments, or only some of them?
Only some of them.
What do you think about the argument in which we said that learning is recollection, and that since this is so, our soul must necessarily have been somewhere before it was imprisoned in the body?
I was wonderfully convinced by it at the time. I still believe it more firmly than any other argument.
And I, too, feel just as he does. But I should be much surprised if I should... Oops, and I should be much surprised if I should ever think differently on this point.
You must then, my Theban friend, think differently if you persist in your opinion that a harmony is a compound and that the soul is a harmony made up of the elements that are strung like harp strings in the body. For surely you will not accept your own statement that a composite harmony existed before those things from which it had to be composed, will you?
Certainly not, Socrates.
Then do you see that this is just what you say when you assert that the soul exists before it enters into the form and body of a man, and that it is composed of things that do not yet exist? For harmony is not what your comparison assumes it to be. The lyre and the strings and the sounds come into being in a tuneless condition. And the harmony is the last of all to be composed, and the first to perish. So how can you bring this theory into harmony with the other?
I cannot at all.
And yet there ought to be a harmony between it and the theory about harmony above all others.
Yes, there ought.
Well, there is no harmony between the two theories. Now, which do you prefer? The knowledge is recollection, or that the soul is a harmony?
The former, decidedly, Socrates. For this other came to me without demonstration. It merely seemed probable and attractive, which is the reason why many men hold it. I am conscious that those arguments which base their demonstration on mere probability are deceptive.
Mm-hmm. Big admission, considering this whole preceding argument is by my book. Well, okay.
And if we are not on our guard against them, they deceive us greatly in geometry and in all other things. But the theory of recollection and knowledge has been established by a sound course of argument. For we agreed that our soul, before it entered into the body, existed, just as the very essence which is called the Absolute exists. Now I am persuaded that I have accepted this essence on sufficient and right grounds. I cannot, therefore, accept from myself or anyone else the statement that the soul is a harmony.
How did he get rid of it? How did he get rid of
it? He made him choose between one that he had been the one that he'd been persuaded of, and this other one that was unlikely.
Yeah, I know. That's true. What convinced him? What caused him to shrink? What did he see when he saw? He saw that this analogy was weird. What caused him to see it was weird?
I thought it had to do with just the juxtaposition. One he saw by demonstration, one he didn't. He saw the dissonance. They were dissonant. They couldn't coexist. And it looks like...
You mean learning and recollection and this analogy?
Yeah, they couldn't coexist. Yeah, so. They were
disheartened. Yeah. But did he also see there was a weakness in his argument?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He saw that too.
Yeah.
Okay. That's further
what
developed.
Did he see at that moment?
That harmony comes after rather than he thought before.
Something,
yeah. Yeah. Harmony is to the soul.
It's the last to come, the first to go.
Yeah. This is really something really curious. This line goes, you see, you have one thing going through this entire argument. And the analogy.
it's really very curious. Clearly.
Let's get back into the argument itself. Right. Let's see if we can just play with it for a moment. Let's go to section 8.6. Now, take it right up and read that. Aaron, can you read that again? And let's see if we can just create everything in the analogy. And I think there's something quite interesting about what Socrates does, though. Really, it's so interesting, and it makes his dialogue so totally different than any other person. Let's do it. 86.
In this, that one might use the same argument about harmony in a lyre with its strings.
Okay, well, I'm going to do.
One might say that the harmony is invisible and incorporeal, and very beautiful and divine.
Invisible, incorporeal. Go ahead.
Very beautiful and divine in the well-attuned lyre.
Beautiful. Yeah, do it again. One might say
that the harmony is invisible and incorporeal and very beautiful and divine in the well-attuned lyre.
Okay. It's in it, right? It's in it. It's in it. Go ahead.
But the lyre itself and the strings are bodies, and corporeal, and composite, and earthy.
Look here. Bodies. Right. This is itself. Right. The lyre, the physical instrument itself.
Is this the view a conceptual view, material view? This grows up out of the coming together of forces,
yeah,
hot and cold. Thoughts are just electrochemical impulse.
And look here, earthly,
you're not set.
And akin to what is
mortal.
Where's mine? Right. So it's akin. These are very similar. Right on. See, notice what he's doing. Keep going.
Now, if someone shatters the lyre or cuts and breaks the strings.
All right, either one.
What if he should maintain by the same argument you employed that the harmony could not have perished and must still exist? For there could be no possibility that the lyre and its strings, which are of mortal nature, still exist after the strings are broken, and the harmony, which is related and akin to the divine and the immortal, perished before that which is mortal.
Therefore, what's he saying? Good line. There'd be no possibility that the lyre and its strings, which are of mortal nature, still exist after the strings are broken. He's saying there's no lyre if you break the strings. Mm-hmm. And the harmony, which is related and akin to the divine, and the perish, right? It perishes before that which is mortal. Right? It would have to perish, wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. When?
Before.
Well, come on, it's going to get a little bit more fun. Yeah, that's right. It's real curious. Don't lose that line. I want to go back to it. Go ahead.
He would say that the harmony must still exist somewhere, and that the wood and the strings must rot away before anything could happen to it.
Well, he's moving to the principles at that point, isn't he? Principles. Go ahead.
It's granted even that.
Pardon me?
Isn't the forces army going to be granted even this?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Throw this in.
And I fancy, Socrates, that it must have occurred to your own mind that we believe the soul to be something after this fashion, that our body is strung and held together.
All right, now notice, all right? Now our body is going to take the image that he's using, all right, is the stringing. All right? So he's picking up his image from here. Therefore, he has a simile afloat here, doesn't he? Go ahead.
And held together, our body is strung and held together by heat, cold, moisture, dryness.
Those are the particular strings then. All right, see how he's doing it? All right? Heat, cold, moisture. That's what he's saying, the body is right. It's strung with those things, right? Agree? Dryness. Okay, now I'm moving over here to the soul. All right, now what's he saying?
Soul is a mixture of harmony. Well, that one more line about the soul. The
yes,
soul
please.
Is a mixture and a harmony of these same elements.
Thank you. What is it?
The soul is a mixture and a harmony of these same elements.
Same elements.
When they are well and properly mixed.
What's he got? Okay, it's a mixture and harmony.
Right. This is the electrochemical view of thinking.
That's right.
Right.
That's what he's got.
Right.
In that sense, there's no difference between the body and the soul.
Right. Isn't this human, all those people?
Yeah.
Right.
That's what he's got. Right. So therefore, you see, this is made of elements. This is made of elements. This is made of elements. This is made of elements.
Yeah.
Right? And he's playing with this term as a metaphor. Because it's not a simile. Right? Now he drops the mixture. Right, he drops the mixture because then someone might say, you see, if he pushed the mixture idea, that you're not talking about anything different in the body. Mm-hmm. So he picks up the metaphor of harmony. Okay, keep going.
Mm-hmm. Now, if the soul is the harmony, it is clear that when the body is too much relaxed or is too tightly strung.
See? He goes back to this image, right? If that's too tight or loosely strong, yeah, then it's ill. Go ahead.
By diseases or other ills, the soul must of necessity perish, no matter how divine it is, like other harmonies and sounds and in all the works of artists.
See what he's done? See, it's strung this way. This is a simile. Then he takes the simile literally, and he says, hey, look, that's the condition for health and disease. Right? Because now he's picking up and stretching. That's what the soul is now, not the mixture, but right? So the body, too, when it's too much relaxed or is too tightly strung by diseases or other ills, the soul must of necessity perish. Look here. This is really one of the greatest arguments against don't relax.
Be uptight.
Right. Be uptight. I mean, there's a comic side to this, isn't there?
Yeah.
Right?
If you relax for a minute, you're pluck her string.
He's stuck with that because slacked, right? When the strings are slacked on the lyre, it doesn't produce any sound. Therefore, no harmony. So he's obliged to use the same here, even though it doesn't fit. Right? To relax.
Really.
Okay. Then it must of necessity perish, no matter how divine it is. Like other harmonies and sounds and all the works of artists in the ring of Jewish
power. But wasn't he saying if the body is too tightly strung or relaxed,
yeah,
the soul perish?
Yeah.
So it's either of those.
Okay. Yeah, too tight, too taunt, and then probably not going to give you the harmonies you need because that's not the right tension and not too much. So either one, you're going to die. So either don't be too relaxed or uptight.
Sure. She came all unstrung the other night.
Went to awake the other night. Went to awake and didn't hear a sound. Knew he was dead.
Yeah, well, this is a theory that ghost world runs.
I think
that
their strings are short.
Right. Midgets are like that.
Okay. And the remains?
That's my children's voice. And the remains. And the remains of each body will endure a long time until they are burnt or decayed. Now what shall we say to this argument? Anyone claims that the soul, being a mixture of the elements of the body, is the first to perish in what is called death.
So, what does it say? Now what's remarkable about Socrates is that he ignores all that. Where we might laugh at him and say, hey, look what you're doing. You know, shall I take apart this argument and show what you're doing? He just accepts it all, just leaves it alone, and he goes for the principle of it.
He lets it all get out, doesn't he?
He always does that. He'll ignore the logic. He won't attack it simply in terms of inconsistencies.
Uh-huh.
He'll assume it's sound and then go, but let's see his argument against it, right? It's all in the impact paragraph. You have it, Barbara?
What was that last sentence you read before you
go
on?
What was the last sentence I read?
Yeah.
What shall we say to this argument if anybody claims that the soul being a mixture of the elements? That one?
Oh, mixture of the elements. Saying the remains last till burn or decay.
Right.
And then that way, the body must last a long time because it persists even when dead. The lyre persists. Does it not when the strings are broken? Because it takes a long time for it to totally decay. Therefore, what's the first thing to die?
The soul.
Therefore, it can't be reborn or anything else like that. It's the first to disappear. Okay, Barbara. All right,
okay.
Good.
You must, my Theban friend, think differently if you persist in your opinion that a harmony is a compound and that the soul...
Let's do it. All right, let me just mark this for a moment. See what he picks up. He picks harmony is a compound or mixture. Yeah.
And that the soul is a harmony made up of the elements.
And the soul is a harmony.
Barb, where are you?
Page 317, 92A. Soul is a harmony made up of the elements that are strung like harp strings in the body. For surely you will not accept your own statement that a composite harmony existed before those things from which it had to be composed, will you?
Right, do it again, right? Because some people wanted to get loose.
Oh, right.
Everyone there? 92? Let's take a look at Rouse 2 next. All right, do it again.
You must, my Theban friend, think differently. If you persist in your opinion that a harmony is a compound and that the soul is a harmony made up of the elements that are strung, like harp strings.
The elements that are strung. He leaves out the mixture, right, but he includes it in a weaker form.
Mm-hmm.
All right. like the yeah. So he picked it, right? He put it all in one. Now, what's the line that does it? It's the next line.
For surely you will not accept your own statement that a composite harmony existed before those things from which it had to be composed, will you?
That's it. For surely you will not accept your own statement that a composite harmony, right? A composite harmony, existed before those things from which it had to be composed. Now, where did he get that?
It's a knowledge is recollection argument.
Yeah. And possibly in this, that even if some were to say that harmony still exists after the instrument is destroyed. Right, when he threw that extra piece in. Okay, keep going.
Then do you see that this is just what you say when you assert that the soul exists before it enters into the form and body of the man, and so that it is composed
he's got
of...
He's got this. He's got this in his argument. This is what he accepts. Right here. Right, this is the big sentence. Soul has a prior existence. He says, "Hey, you got a problem now. If you say that the soul is dependent upon the mixture and the harmony, respectively, of the parts and the way they combine, then how can you hold the position that the soul existed prior to the entrance into the body? What is? How does he get him?"
Put together thing.
Therefore, he should have said. He should have said to keep his position, to keep his analogy. He could have said that it's only at that moment when the lyre fully is brought into existence and is strung that harmony comes into existence. And in the same way, as soon as the body is fused, total and composed, at that moment enters into the soul. Then you don't have the prior argument, prior existence argument.
Prior existence that they're worried about that some at some point in time that existence
right.
stops. Yeah.
And he didn't have to hold on.
Yeah.
But where does this come from? Again, where does this come from?
A recollection.
Recollection argument.
Argument.
That's right. Same as the other. That's why he introduced it. Say, hey, by the way, does this demolish all of our previous arguments or only some? He said, oh, just some. Well, how about the doctrine of recollection, Lenny's recollection? Oh, no, I still hold that as for, oh, okay, you hold that. Boom.
Does this tie in with his method here later on about always fighting the strongest argument? I mean, it's like, is he forcing you to pick a stronger argument in some way?
You mean I love the Hercules? I love it.
No, he lays down principles of how he examines things. He always finds the strongest principle, logo, or because he's forcing him to give up one there for something he finds stronger. Right?
Yes, I said that's a fine example. No, I didn't say that. You did.
I didn't ask.
Yeah.
I was asking if this could function as a candidate for that.
Yes, I do. Yes, I think it was a fine point. But would you agree that all of the difficulties in this position, especially about taking a metaphor literally, right? So thinking this is the proper use of similes and metaphors. He doesn't touch any of that. Right? He just says, why?
This is real Zen, isn't it? I mean, yeah. Sorts of
one sentence does it, doesn't it?
Exactly.
Right? Right? That's all. He lets it stand. He lets it stand. Yeah. Whereas, that's the difference he makes between this, remember? Heuristic reasoning and dialectic. These people who are heuristic reasoners just go for contradictions and ambiguities. That's where they reside. So dialecticians have to go to the principles behind them.
You're quantifying into a fake context. He says,
what?
See, where harmony is not what your comparison assumes it to be. The lyre and the strings and the sounds come into being in a tuneless condition. The harmony is the last of all to be composed in the first appearance. Yet there ought to be a harmony between it, the theory about harmony above all others. Yeah, that's a nice play on words, isn't it, Socrates?
That's really good.
There's no harmony between the two theories. Now, which do you prefer? To have your head? Or to walk out without your shoes?
By far, my head.
Okay, so now he's going to do an exploration from this point on. We need to go through four pages. What time, huh?
9:15.
That's it.
Right.
We're right there?
Huh? Yeah.
God, the time's moving right.
God, that was great.
Now, let me give you an assignment, okay? Only for those who want to play.
So we're stopping at 92D.
Yeah. Just before he then goes into the analysis of the analogy.
You could erase your analogy up there because you've written it down. Most people, if you need a section,
just a little corner. Don't encourage it.
Really?
Go to page 327. Very well, said Socrates. Harmonia, the Theban goddess, has, it seems, been moderately gracious to us. But now, Cebes, and by what argument can we find grace in the sight of Cadmus? Two names, Cadmus and Harmonia, We need some people to do some nice-looking into mythology. Run those two names down. Right? Run them down and show their role in the dialogue. Easily enough, we can do that. He's aware of it, so are they. Now, Simmias and Cebes are both from Thebes. We know that from the beginning of the dialogue. So, how does Harmonia and Cadmus relate to the Thebean religions, state religions? And then we can play with the level of what is Socrates doing in respect to these views? In other words, what if it turns out that Simmias and Cebes' views are directly related to that mythology, the mythology from Thebes?
Says that their fear, their problems are outgrowths of their upbringing.
Of their religion, their upbringing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So all you have to do when you go to another culture is to find out what mythology, find out what religion and mythology does, then you'll be able to understand the conflicts they have in philosophy.
That's right.
Because that's what he's doing. Yeah. Right? Because he can't continue his prophetic voice until later in the dialogue. He goes back to it, of course, and then does finish it. So first he has to remove their fear. Their fears are basically from their own religion, which is then incompatible with the philosophy. So first they disguised it with fears of the many, then they had to finally divulge their own point of view. Okay, Mark, did we...